welcome our online family that's joining us right now. Stand with us, if you will, please. Come on, let's worship the Lord today.
Jesus is mine and I'm forgiven. I'm holding his head. I'm going to heaven. 'Cause I found a wonderful Savior who blesses me forever. I'm his and thank God he is mine. Well, he's my rock, my sword, my shield. He's the meal in the middle of the wheel. He's the lily of the valley. He's the bright and morning star. Makes no difference what you say. I'm going on my knees to pray. I'm going to wait right here for Jesus till he comes. You said, I'm going on my knees to pray. I'm going to wait right here for Jesus till he comes. I'm going to wait right here for Jesus till he
preacher, driving on a midnight bus bound for Mexico. One was headed for vacation, one for higher education. Two of them were searching for a lost soul. That driver never ever saw that stop sign. An 18-wheelers can't stop. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's none for a good, heaven only knows.
Yes, it's
not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go.
Well, that farmer had a harvest, a home and 80 acres. Faith in love, growing things in his young son's heart. And that teacher left her wisdom in the minds of lots of children, hoping they would make a better start. And that preacher said, can't you see the promised land as he held that blood-stained Bible in that hooker's hand?
There are crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows.
Yes, it's
not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go.
That's the story our preacher told last Sunday. He held the blood-stained Bible up for all of us to see. And he said, bless the teacher, the farmer, a preacher. Who gave this Bible to my mama who read it to me?
There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. While there's not four of them, heaven only knows.
Yes, it is.
Not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go.
There are
three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway.
Oh, Mr. Dave Savage is going to sing us something this morning.
Would surely be me. I thought I could be, wanted to be. I thought I could build on life's sinking sand, but now I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Thought I could do it a lot on my own. I thought I could make it all day long. I thought of myself as a mighty big man, but Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, that's where I learned to stand. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. I think I'll make Jesus my all and all. If I'm in trouble, on his name I'll call. If I didn't trust him, I'd be less of a man. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, that's where I learned to stand. But now I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. The mountains too high and the valleys too wide. Down on my knees, that's where I learned to stand. But Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Oh Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hand.
a hand clap.
Yeah.
Come on, don't you feel like when all of hell has come at you all week, all of heaven opens up for you when you begin to praise Him? I believe there's an open heaven here this morning. Let's fix our eyes on Jesus just a little bit more this morning. What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes, when I find myself standing in the sun. When all I will do is forever worship you, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Oh, let's sing. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Oh, I can only imagine. By your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Give Jesus a hand. That's the promise that we have. Amen. Let's exalt Him together. He said, if I be exalted, I will lift. myself up among all men. Let's exalt Him this morning.
I
voices, come on. We exalt thee above everything.
We exalt thee.
It's all about you, Jesus.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, we exalt thee. And we
exalt thee.
Oh, we put you in your rightful place.
We exalt thee.
Above it all.
We exalt thee. Oh,
oh, come on, give Jesus praise.
Thank you, Lord. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for what we sense here this morning. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your anointing. Lord, as we move now into your precious living word, touch every heart, touch every life, Lord. Minister life to us. Oh, Jesus, pour out your spirit on us this day, every single person, everyone watching, Lord. Let your perfect will be accomplished in every single life. And as we open ourselves up and receive from you today, we're thanking you for your very best. We're here to love you and adore you. We're here to talk with you. We're here to receive from you. And for all of it, we give you praise. In Jesus' wonderful name. And everyone together said a good amen. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you so very, very much. Thank you guys so, so very much. Thomas, would you come here, please, sir? Would you take this cross and put it right where those two microphone stands are? You'll need to push them back just a little bit. You may need to help him. Thank you, Lord. Somebody get the lights, if you will, please. If you're here, you've got your Bibles with you, or you want to make notes, you'll be able to do that. I want to go back and we're talking about, if you will, sit this chair over there and put that one over there and get them out of the way for me, please, sir. Yeah, take that one to the other side. Thanks. We're talking about prayer last week, and I'm just going to pick up where we were last week just a little bit and take you a little further from Matthew 6, 9 through 13 as a pattern that Jesus gave us. And I think most everyone knows the Lord's Prayer, our Father which art in heaven. Did we have that? Yes, it's up here. Hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. You look at the Lord's Prayer. You go back and look at the old tabernacle as a pattern. And one of the things that we said last week, that not only for this 3 weeks, but it is important that we look at Jesus for an example. We look at what he gave us as an example, and we build patterns into our lives that will help us not only pray consistently, but pray and come to the Lord or worship the Lord in a way that will be meaningful not only to the Lord, but to us as well. So one of the things I said last week is we're never going to live well. We're never going to love well without following his example. And the thing is, for a lot of people, sometimes your breakthrough, or that place that you need to be, that place that you need to go, that place of joy, that place of blessing sometimes can just be one ingredient away, just one single step away. And maybe in this time where we're focusing on prayer or getting ready for the building, or something that you hear or something that you begin to incorporate into your life will be that one more ingredient, that one last step that you needed to take before all of heaven breaks out on top of you. How many of you know that just even one single ingredient can make a difference in just a whole lot of stuff, right? Including food. It seems like a lot of times when I eat, there's always one ingredient missing, and that quite often is Tabasco. Tabasco. I love hot sauce. I love hot sauce on rice. I love hot sauce on broccoli. I don't eat hot sauce on my apple fritters, but I do like it on almost anything else. But just one ingredient. If you're used to having something with sugar, you can have the best drink, the best tea in the world, especially if you're Southern. But without tea, it is lacking, to say the least. But one step away, following Him, following the Lord as an example. And we can sometimes be just that close. And one of the things we said, and I'll say it to you again this morning, find a time, find a place, and then develop a plan and a pattern. Finding a place doesn't seem to be too difficult for us for a lot of things. We seem to be able to decide on and pick a place to do most anything. For instance, we picked this place to meet, to gather together on Sundays. So you have a designated time, a designated place to come on Sundays to meet together with the church family and with the Lord, right? It's not a difficult concept, but sometimes something we haven't put in place in our lives as we connect with the Lord every day, as we talk to the Father, we pray, we bless the Lord, we bring our prayers to Him. But we need to, one of the things that will help you a lot is if you'll develop that in your life. And it doesn't have to be the same place, but it needs to be something that you plan on and you're determined to do. I promise you, if you do not build patterns or process or something consistent, thought through, a forethought that you've applied to when it comes to praying, I promise you that there'll be things in this world that'll happen every single day. If the systems of this world or the devil can find a way to pull you away of being close to God, it'll happen. Something will break down. Someone will call you. Something will pop up on your calendar. Dave, I just cannot get away from this. Dave and Penny, would you please, Steve, take his coffee. Would you all come up here, please? This is world worthy, right? We're on TV all over the world. Come on now, come up here so we can get a good camera shot of you. Come on and turn around so everybody can see you really, really good. 19th wedding anniversary today. Come on. They said it was, how many years before you realized you'd gotten married on St. Patrick's Day?
About 8.
About 8 years. But once you did, you decided to really live it up on your anniversary, right? Amen. Hey, give them one more big hand clap. Isn't that terrific? Something will happen. Something will test your resolve. It'll happen in every single thing that goes. As long as we live in this world, there's always going to be something that'll test you, try you, pull at you, whether it's in your own personal makeup, spirit, soul, or body, or whether it's something going on around you, or whether it's an all-out attack from the devil. Something will happen to pull you away. Unless you are devoted, committed, those are tough words. They're really, really hard. Forgive me, millennials. They're really, really hard for millennials especially. But for everyone, it's difficult. If you do not put that into the equation of your connecting with the Lord and praying, I promise you, something will pull you away. Committed, dedicated, resolved, planned, something that you orchestrate in your life. This is something that I do every day. I plan on every day. I'm committed to every day. It's as important as the air that I breathe or the food that I eat or the place that I live or the work that I go to. How many of you can show up at work every week, right? Yeah, it's just not that hard, but it just needs to be applied to your connecting with the Lord. Same thing about time. Having a place, having a time, dedicating a time. Any of you keep any appointments at all? Anybody keep appointments? Doctor, you show up at work on time? Some people show up at work on time. Thank the Lord. I'm sure your employers are excited about the fact that you show up to work. But it wasn't a difficult concept, right? It was a time that you set apart. Some people were fortunate enough to go to part of the SEC championship games. Where are you? Yeah, back here, yeah. you had a ticket, you knew it was important. There was investment involved. You knew when to show up. You set the time. He lets us do that. But you set the time. You knew it was important for you to be there, and you were there. The crazier our world gets, the more that is at stake about our having this ongoing living relationship with the Lord. It's not about religion. It's not about a denomination. It's not about any of those things. It's about a relationship that you started, that you covenanted with Him when you said at some point in your life, Lord, I want you to come into my life. I need you. I need you to forgive me. I need a Savior. I'm asking you to be the Lord of my life. Now come live your life in me by your Spirit and let me live my life in you. The Bible is called Old Testament, New Testament, Old Covenant, Agreement, Commitment by two parties, New Covenant. New Covenant established on His part by the price that He paid that we could not, and the blood that He was shed. And Him taking that very blood into the heavenlies, of which the earthly tabernacle was a type of, and presenting His own blood in the heavenlies and applying it to that altar, so that that covenant, as far as His side was concerned, is established forever for anyone whosoever will. Calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. There was a point in time, if there wasn't, we'll help you do that before this morning's over, a point in time that you entered into that covenant with Him, and that relationship with Him. And now He won't chase you all the days of your life. He won't pursue you all the days of your life. He won't run after you as though being with Him or knowing Him is unimportant. But He will make a way for you if you will turn and reach out to Him. Draw near to the Lord and He shall draw near to you. Call on Him and He shall hear and answer. It's the way that it works. So now it's incumbent, or it's put on you now, this incredible privilege, and up to you now to daily nurture that, to daily. It is important. I don't just see Joanna once a week or once a month. I live with her. We do things together. We talk regularly. We share things together. It's not something that I just get to every now and then, or even on a Sunday morning. Hey, I need to catch up with the one I have covenanted also with in this life as man and wife. We entered into a covenant. When people come to me to ask me to marry them, that's what's going on. They've asked me to, on their behalf, to call on the Lord and ask for His blessing on the covenant that they are making together, so that He becomes the eternal third party that always keeps that together. Without Him, that covenant may be very, very important. It could stand a lot of things, but it'll never be perfect without Him. So that's what they're asking me to do. That's what's going on. And then they spend the rest of their life, if they want it to last forever, working on that and meaningful and doing things that are ongoing. That's what He's asking us to do. That's the privilege that we have. So we make a time, we make a place for Him in our lives, and then we need a plan or a pattern, something that helps us. By and large, unless you've lived for the Lord for a very, very long time, you know a whole lot of scripture and you have a lot of experience with him, you're just like a calf at a new gate. You're just not sure what to do. And that's okay. That's not a bad thing. That's a normal thing. It's just like any other child. So many of us have raised kids and grandkids. What happens with them? If we don't teach them, if they're not around us to develop language and conversation, we don't teach them the things to do. There's a learning process. And it's why it's so important for young believers to be connected to people that have served the Lord longer and be in church and all those kinds of things so that you begin to learn. You may or may not have ever been exposed to worship like this or feel some of the things that you feel sometimes when we're worshiping together, but we're growing in that, and you feel like there's something really special about it. And you're watching people raise their hands or have some expression, or you're watching Quentin do a little buck dance in the early part of the service out in the aisle or something like that, and you're saying, "Hey, there's some things I can learn to do that help me express my love for the Lord." But we look for a plan. We look for an example. We look to Jesus as an example. So the first thing, I think we touched on this last week, was to make him first and acknowledge him as your first priority, and acknowledge and praise him for who he is. Psalms 34, 1 through 3, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make boast in the Lord." It's an attitude that we come to him with. I'm going to brag on you. I'm here to talk about you. The most important thing in my life is that I honor you and am a blessing to you because I was created, Revelation 4, for your good pleasure. Asked the question last week, is there anyone in your life that you would make an effort to please even before yourself? How much more should we do that for him? One of the songs that we learned to sing years and years ago is "I Love You, Lord, and I Lift My Voice." And it, in the conclusion of that is like this. It says, "Let me be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I love you, Lord." Anybody know it? "And I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear." You just can't even imagine what happens in heaven when you do that, and when you do it on a Thus says the Lord again, thus says the Lord, again there shall be heard in this place of which you say, it's desolate without man or without beast in the city of Judah, cities of Jerusalem, those places that are desolate, without man, without inhabitant, without beast, the voice of joy, the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, the voice of the bride, the voice of those who will say. It's the very thing that Jesus came to do. This was declared not only of a time long ago, but a prophetic time that was to come after Jesus had come and what he does for us, so that the voice of those of us that know him, both the bridegroom and the bride, will say, praise the Lord of hosts, for the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. And of those who will bring what? The sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. For those people, I will cause all these things to happen. For I will cause the captives of the land to return as at first, says the Lord. He will do that for us. For those that bring a sacrifice of praise. A sacrifice of praise. You know what that is? It is words. It is an offering. It is what you determine to do on a daily basis to bring to the Lord. It's very, very much like this. Somebody just kill these lights in the room just for a moment so folks can kind of focus on what I'm doing. On a daily basis, we should be doing this. I'm trying to teach you about prayer, about communicating to the Lord, and about building a pattern. We've over the last few years given you some handouts and all this kind of stuff, but I wanted to do just something a little different with it this year. And I want to help you on Sunday mornings build this into your life. A lot of folks just simply cannot imagine where their life could be transformed into if you can just get these few things together. So on a daily basis, this is really what you need to do. And you're going to come to the Lord. So I've got all my cares and all my troubles, and I need to talk to him about it. But right now there's something more important going on. Because I love you more than life. He's not just granddaddy to me, or not just, he's not my banker, he's not just my counselor, he's not just someone that I come to when I need money or need help or need health. He's the lover of my soul and the most important. This is what it should be. This is what it can be. The most important thing in my life. He is the most important person in my life. And my Father and my Lord and Savior, my elder brother Jesus, the precious Holy Spirit that comes to not only live inside me, but well up inside me and burst over and flow over, just consuming my life. There is nothing more important. And right now, it's my time. This is my place. And there's much to talk about, but first things first, and he's first. So the first thing I've done is I just kind of put these away. I have a lot. There's things going on in my family. There's things going on around me, and the world's going to hell in a handbasket, and there's trouble everywhere, and I got a thumb that don't work good, and I've got my this, and I've got that. But right now, there's nothing more important than just coming to see you for a little while. So I'm gonna lay this right here, and we'll we'll deal with that later when it's the proper time. And then I've got a lot of things that I enjoy. I've got all kinds of stuff that's, you know, really important to me. And, you know, I got my horses, I got my cows, I got, you know, cowboy buys a saddle, it lasts a lifetime. They hand it down to their children. It's really, really important. A hat like this will, for people like me, it's really, really important how I handle it, what I do with it, how I keep it. I hand it down to my children, be in my family forever. These are important things to me, along with a lot of others. But even these, Father, they're really, really important, and I'm grateful for them. But that's not what's most important right now. It's not the most important thing. I've got some gifts for you today. I've been working on this and planning it. I couldn't hardly wait from yesterday to today, because what I read in here and what I've learned is it's where miracles are the atmosphere. It's where joy is. It's where peace is. It's all those things. But most importantly, it's where you are, because you are all those things. And it says to bring, enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise, and to bring him the sacrifice of worship. So that's not only myself, but I actually have gifts. I put them together, and I've been working on this since last we met. And you know, I try to bring you something every day because you're so important to me. And I know the thing that blesses you the most is comes straight from your living word. So I've planned to worship you today. I set this time. I picked this place. And I've brought you some gifts. And I'm just going to open them. And Father, from your own word, Psalms 86, 8 through 10. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you. O Lord, you shall glorify your name. I glorify your name. For you are great, and you do wondrous things. You alone are God. And I bring you this sacrifice of praise. I honor you from the best place that I can get it. There's a lot of things that you've done in my life, but out of your very own word, your own declarations, you are God. You are among all the world. You are the great God, and there's none like you, nobody like you. And so exciting. I learned a chorus years ago. It said, we bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. We offer up to you sacrifices of joy. You know, sometimes I don't know exactly what to say, but I want this to mean something. It's important to me. I'm kind of like a kid at Christmas time right now, because it's not just because I'm getting something. I have something in him and who he is and what he means to me. He is important to me. And I have learned how to be a blessing to him. I've learned how to love him. I've learned how to honor him. I've got this other gift from Jeremiah 16 and 10. And it says, but the Lord is the true God. That's who you are, Lord. You're the true God. There's nobody bigger than you. There's nobody even equal to you. Nobody besides you. And all the earth and all the heavens and all of history are in all of future. You're the biggest thing that's ever been. You are the living God. You are the everlasting King. See, you can get some of these too. You can just pluck them right out of Scripture and jot them down if nowhere else. Just write in the back of your Bible. There's always a few pages to write on there. And when you go to him on a daily basis and you've picked a time, Jenny, and you've picked a place, and Dave, you've worked on this, and through the day you've just kind of been thinking through, and you know there's coming a time where in the next hours or the next morning or in the middle of driving when you take a break. That's when my dad did it. My dad drove over the road for a long time, but he'd make time. He'd pull into a rest stop somewhere, and I was with him. And it didn't matter what was going on. The most important thing in his life was the Jesus that had saved him. And he'd pull over to the side, and he'd lay that Bible up on the steering wheel of that big Kenworth. And he'd go to talking to the Lord. So you could do this too. This is how you live. This becomes your life. He's not just a word. He's not just black ink on white pages in this leather-bound book or in the electronic devices that you carry. He's real. He's alive. He's living. He's powerful. His his presence is extraordinary. And I have to live there. I've lived on the other side. Orville, I've lived where it's dry, hurtful, lonely, fearful. And I don't like it. I don't ever want to go back there. I've got a place where there's fullness of joy. And so I'm here every day, and I've got this other gift, and it says, at his wrath, the earth quakes, and the nations cannot endure his indignation. My God's a big deal. I don't care what any country, any nation, anybody, any people raise up. I don't care what the devil cries out or what comes against me. I don't care what's going on. My God's the big Father. You're the big deal. You're bigger than anything. Hey, I've got two more. I've been waiting on this. This one's from Psalms 8. Father God, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above all the heavens. And out of the mouth of babes and infants, you have established strength because of your foes to steal the enemy and the avenger. And when I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, oh, what is man that you are mindful of him? Father, what am I that you would be mindful even of me? But I sure am glad you did. And what is the Son of Man that you care for him? Yet you have made him lower than the heavenly beings, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. Father, I can't even begin to imagine what all that means. But I know that as we spend time together, you'll help me understand what it means to be crowned with glory and honor. Right now, I just want to say, oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. This is my sacrifice of praise to you today. This is me blessing your name. And I'm thankful, oh Lord, that anybody can do this. Everybody can. I've got one more. I'm sorry that it's pink, but Joanna helped me pick it out. So, matter of fact, I had two pink ones. This is, Lord, is this fuchsia? Why did you make this color? I don't even know what it's called. But here we go. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. Well, I feel better already. I hadn't been here long at all. Just being near you. I got the distractions out of the way and my problems out of the way and the things that I sometimes mistakenly act like I love the most in life out of the way, and nobody's around, my cell phone's turned off. I just, where I can have just a little quiet time with you. And you know, it's part of what we want to do out at our land. We're so excited about it. We're going to help people find Jesus in the country, Jesus at the creek bank, Jesus in the hayfield, Jesus on the horseback, Jesus in that big old barn. We're going to help people find him, one of the easiest places in the world they can find him. But Lord, this is from 1 Chronicles 29:11. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord. And you are exalted as head above all. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory. And in this place, and in this moment, where I have worshiped, prayer is worship. There's no worship in prayer. It's kind of empty. And the world has kind of lost that, if they ever knew it at all, or if they've never known it. They think it's asking for stuff. A lot of people all over the place, you hear them praying about all kinds of stuff. I have no idea what they're talking about. Tell me how you worship. You talk to me about praying, tell me how you really worship. And I'll understand whether you really know him or not. And if you don't, I want to introduce you to him. Because he will change who you are. And in this place, I've worshiped my way into. And there in his presence, everything changes. Everything. You see, this is what moves him to respond. This is what blesses him and how he wants to operate. And just as much as if I brought you an incredible gift, my brother, you would be bound to respond. You would have to respond. He's not some monster or a robot. He is someone that we can understand completely by our own makeup. Miss Nellie, if I give you a gift, you're going to be joyful about it. You're going to say something about it. Oh, can I bless you too? What can I do for you? When you worship, when you pray like this, there is pandemonium that takes place in heaven. The angels get into a frenzy and they watch you doing what they were created to do, and they see the reality of who we are and these special created vessels that we are and how we're worshiping our Father and the Lord Jesus, and they just get into a frenzy running around taking care of stuff and doing all kinds of things and working on our behalf. It releases His anointing. It releases His blessing. He's not that it's automatic, but it's because He's that personable. Like the woman with the issue of blood, Luke 8:43-38. We press in. Like the blind man waiting patiently, we press in through the crowd. Then suddenly a touch from heaven. Jesus came and rescued me. That's what He does. She pressed through. She prayed through all the crowd and all the mess. Jesus said, I perceive that virtue is gone from me. When you pray yourself into His presence, He cannot help but respond. It releases His anointing. Even before you unpack your junk, and it brings victory in your life. In one place in Isaiah, it says the anointing breaks the yoke. The anointing is His knowable presence. The anointing break. It doesn't just only break it. The word there in the Hebrew is that it utterly destroys it so that it could never come back. And then in the New Testament, it says where the in 2 Corinthians 3:17, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. You know what that freedom is? It's the breaking off of everything that inhibits and holds you back. If you can get here, if you can get here, by the time you're through worshiping Him and honoring Him, well, I can't get. Oh, thank you. It's gone. I brought all this junk to show Him, for Him to take care of it. And I'd almost forgot about it. But it's already gone. I didn't even have to tell Him. While I was loving on Him and adoring Him and reminding Him of my love for Him, He just took it all away. And it will never come back. That's the one I love. That's who He is. I'm trying to teach you about prayer and the one that I've come to know over almost 40 years, 41 years. He's more than you can ever imagine. He's greater than you can ever declare. He's sweeter than anything you can even begin to imagine or dream of. He is all that He is because He is. And He's all that you need. Can you say amen to that? I'm going to ask our musicians to come back. Make it priority. Pick your place. Plan a time. Get some gifts. Gather you together some scripture. If nothing else, write it down. remember the times that he touches your life and blesses you so that you make a memorial of those things that he does in your life. Put it in your Bible or somewhere so that when you come before him, you have brought gifts, and you'll be surprised at what he can do with your problems. Amen. I exalt thee. Will you stand with me, please? Could we just for a moment just worship him? Would you just close everything out of your mind? Lay your troubles aside. Push them out of your mind, out of your heart. And just for a moment, as we close this service, I'm sorry I've kept you so long, but this is so important. This will change your life forever. Can we just exalt him? Exalt him means to we're lifting him up above everything else, our own life and everything that's going on around us. Pam, can you just look around that cross there? Okay.
For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth.
You bring him words. You bring him your heart and you tell him about it.
Thou art exalted.
Anybody can do this.
Far above.
Anybody. Come on, everybody, sing and lift your voices.
Will I exalt thee? We lift you up. I exalt thee. Name above all names. I exalt thee.
Honor you and worship you today with everything that is within us. Lord, if there's any one thing that you do with this church, this body of believers and family here and from wherever they watch, pour out your spirit. Walk among us. Befriend us. Lord, love on us as we love on you. Let us become that place and that people among whom you come to sit down and make your home with. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we adore you. We adore you. And Lord, and then in that place, let every need be met. Let them just kind of vanish and be removed, Lord. And we didn't even have to concentrate on it. We just walked, worshiped our way into your presence. Lord, this very morning, let every wound be healed. Let every sickness be broken. Let every chain be destroyed. Let blind eyes be opened, deaf ears open. Lord, let the lame walk again. Let every infirmity be bound and cast away from us, destroyed forever in the name of Jesus. Let a freedom and a liberty come, Lord, that lifts us out of the mundane, Lord, the drudgery of this life, and lifts us up into a realm where you live and exist, where there's joy unspeakable and full of glory, where there's life everlasting, Lord, where there's peace that passes all understanding and that flows like a river in our lives. Let our love for you and one another be so contagious that the world who lives with so little, that is so far away and not even knowing it, so that they see, Lord, and are drawn to the one that we love. Lord, I speak life over every person today. Liberty, freedom, fullness. Your perfect will to be accomplished in every life. Thank you, Lord. You, O Lord, are a great God. This morning, before we close this service, y'all can just continue to play just softly, please. If you don't know this Jesus that we proclaim here, and you'd like to, you know, we can pray with you right where you are, and whether you're watching or here in this room, or whether you've just, it's just never been, there's just something been missing, there's something wrong, whether it's something you did or didn't do, or your fault or nobody's fault, you just know it's not what it needs to be. You prayed that prayer before, but you know you need to do that again. You need to finally get this right. Right where you are. Every head bowed, every eye closed, between you and the Lord, but so that I know who I'm praying with. If that's you, could you just stick your hand up toward heaven and say, yeah, yes, I give you my life today. Yes, pray with me, pray for me, and everybody in this room. Pray this prayer and say, dear Father God, I come to you today knowing I need a Savior. So I say, Jesus, I believe in you. Come live in my life. Forgive me of my sins. Let me live in you. Be the Lord of my life, now and forever, in your holy name. Now, Father, I thank you and I praise you, Lord, because your word is true. If we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, then we'll be saved. Now, Lord, do that work, Lord, in every single life. And we give you praise for it today in Jesus' name. For if you did that today, whether you're watching or here in this room, get you a Bible, connect with us, reach out to us, write us if you need help, contact someone, let someone know what you've done today, let it become a reality everywhere around you, not just in your heart. It's not a hidden thing. But let him do his work in you. One more time, I exalt thee. Come on, let's sing it together.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee.
I exalt thee. Oh, Lord.
I exalt thee.
I exalt thee, Lord.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine on you, keep you, give you grace and peace in absolutely every part of your life, on every side. May the Lord give His angels charge over you. Let no weapon formed against you prosper, but may those angels lift you up and keep you and bear you up in their very own hands, lest you even dash your foot against a stone. May the Lord supply all your needs according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Be blessed in the country, be blessed in the city. Be blessed coming in and be blessed going out. Be the head and not the tail, and only and always be above, and never beneath, in Jesus' wonderful name. If you agree that with that and receive it, give the Lord a good amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. We'll see you next week. God bless you. You're dismissed.